Humans like building really big things. Sometimes it's because a dude wants a monument to show the world how great he is, even when he's dead. Sometimes it's because we want to show nature who's boss and make a place more livable than it was before, whether or not it messes things up for everything else that lives there. And sometimes it's because a really big thing is the only way we know to understand some of the tiniest bits of reality itself. In this episode, we're gonna look at some of the most massive things humans have ever built, and some of the interesting science that happened along the way. Let's start with one of the classics, literally. The Great Pyramid at Giza, which clocks in at over 5 million metric tons and is made of over 2 million giant granite and limestone blocks. It was built around 4,500 years ago for the pharaoh Khufu to serve as his personal tomb. And even though it's that old, we're still fascinated by how those workers did it. Of course, people have floated a lot of ideas over the years, from literally floating the blocks via water trenches to more fantastic hypotheses. But thanks to archaeological evidence and modern experiments with stone cutting tools, some archaeologists think this massive vanity project might have needed a scant 20,000 people who made use of both really good planning and really big ramps. We'd love to know more about what's going on inside this giant, but not entirely solid, stack of blocks, but there's a bit of a problem. Digging things up in order to poke around or taking a bunch of samples would definitely diminish the pyramid's majesty, so scientists have to turn to less invasive techniques, like ground-penetrating radar or showers of subatomic particles that came from space. But how about using a massive building to study the world around it? In 1984, the Romanian dictator Nicolae Ceausescu started construction on, or just like Khufu millennia before him, ordered people to start constructing what might be the heaviest building in the modern world. Today, it's called the Palace of the Parliament, and also today, it's not technically done. Ceausescu's government was toppled 5 years into the project, and while construction continued in the 90s, most of the 1,100 rooms were never finished. Still, this thing clocks in at roughly 4 million metric tons, which, yes, is not heavier than the pyramid, but it is slightly bigger in terms of volume. And one of the cool things with having a building that size is that scientists can monitor how it settles and moves over time. For example, both radar and interferometry, a ray to track distances and movement using beams of light, suggest that different parts of the palace are both rising and sinking. And in 2017, scientists used this huge administration building to investigate tectonic activity in Bucharest. It's not causing the activity, the Earth itself is doing that, but the building is so weighty and covers so much of the underlying bedrock that it's a good case study in a way that a smaller house or a jumble of separate houses just isn't. Researchers took measurements at different parts of the building and found that they could map out fractures and fissures in the palace's structure as if it was a mini tectonic plate. They also revealed that the entire city of Bucharest may be subtly shifting thanks to a nearby tectonic fault system to the east of the city. But what if you could fit a whole city into a building? This concept, often called an arcology, is mostly science fiction, but Saudi Arabia is working on a 170-kilometer-long building/city in the middle of the desert called The Line. Take this news with a grain of salt, though. It's a proposed megaproject, and history has a long list of defunct proposed megaprojects, but we wanted to highlight this one because it's so recent, and, well, for other reasons we'll get into. The idea behind The Line is to build one very narrow but very, very, very long building that'll contain everything people would need to survive. Kind of like a massive linear mall, I suppose, with people moving around via subway. While construction has technically started, we can't guess how heavy the project will end up being, whether it's the size of a city or not. But we're highlighting this mega project in part because of the potential consequences that could arise when you build something this big. Some of the more fanciful design plans, like constructing a fake moon to shine down on the city, or painting the beach sand to glow, would probably definitely be bad for animals living in the area, but there may be more mundane ecological and environmental problems too. For example, one study suggests there'd be a significant risk of oil spills. Plus, if you're building what's essentially a 500 meter tall solid fence, you'll wind up dividing animal ranges and mess with air currents and water flow. But we already have finished examples to show how massive structures can affect the environment around them. Like China's Three Gorges Dam contains roughly 28 million cubic meters of concrete. With a little back of the envelope math, that means the concrete alone would clock in at around 67 million metric tons. And that's not taking into account all the steel and machinery inside. But if we can count not just the building itself, but what it's holding back, the Three Gorges Dam and other dams like it may well be the heaviest structures we've ever created. Because it holds back 40 cubic kilometers of water, weighing 40 billion metric tons. And that's a drop in the bucket compared to the Bratsk Reservoir in Russia, which is holding 170 billion metric tons of water. It's been speculated that big reservoirs like these contain enough mass to alter how the Earth wobbles as it spins, like putting just a little extra weight onto one part of a spinning top. But if you want to talk about big things humans have made, we may want to abandon the concept of a building entirely and embrace the Earth-altering thing. Because there's also a very long history of humans making whole islands. In Scotland and Ireland, Neolithic people made small islands called crannogs to live on, often by driving a circle of wooden stakes into a lake or riverbed, and then filling in the middle with whatever was on hand, like rocks or soil. And over in the Aztec Empire, they created artificial floating islands called chinampas for farming. These are still used in Mexico today and feature woven fences surrounding piled up soil. But of course, if humans are going to build something, we're eventually going to build it big. To make the Palm Jumeirah Archipelago off the coast of Dubai, builders had to dredge up and then pile together 120 million cubic meters of sand, which, depending on the density, would land somewhere around 180 million metric tons. And something like a quarter of the Netherlands is what's called reclaimed land, created from a combination of pumping water out of low-lying wetlands, blocking off water with dikes, and sometimes building up land with sand or earth. But of course, the largest island we've ever made is the continent of Africa, because all it took was building the Suez Canal. With how varied artificial islands are and how they're made, their size, and what we do with them, it's hard to make broad generalizations about their impact. But we do know that, kind of by definition, they involve turning one ecosystem, like a lake bed or a shoreline, into another one. Their presence can also affect water currents in the rest of the lake or shoreline, or increase erosion. Luckily, there are also some positives to artificial islands, like protecting, restoring, or even creating important ecosystems like mangroves and wetlands. Not only do they serve as havens for biodiversity, they can help protect human infrastructure from the ocean. Of course, whether you're trying to build a building or an entire island, you're going to need some machinery. And maybe that's what you're really interested in. It's one thing to stack a bunch of building materials on top of one another, but how big can we make something that also has a lot of complicated parts?
Danke Babble for supporting this SciShow video. If connecting more with other people or taking on new adventures is on your list of goals for 2025, you can turn to Babble as one of the top language learning apps in the world. And I know new goals can be intimidating to start, especially when you're not confident speaking a new language. Sometimes you feel embarrassed practicing with someone else, and that's where Babble's new AI conversation partner can help. You can't embarrass yourself in front of an algorithm. Babble makes the most of AI and real language teachers' expertise with lessons created by more than 650 language experts. Start speaking a new language in 3 weeks with Babble. Click the link in the description or scan the QR code to get 60% off your Babble subscription.
One candidate for the heaviest land vehicle is Bagger 293, a mining machine that weighs a hefty 14,000 metric tons. But the heaviest movable object, period, may well be the Troll A offshore gas platform. It clocks in at a whopping 656,000 metric tons. And these big offshore platforms have some serious engineering behind them, since they need to be able to withstand the physical force of the ocean, as well as the corrosive power of seawater. For example, they've got these giant structures built into them that work kind of like springs, helping to dissipate the energy of the massive waves that batter the platform. These kinds of offshore platforms have historically been used for oil extraction, but these days we're seeing them increasingly used for wind power instead, which is much cooler. Of course, once that wind is captured or that oil is burned, the energy still has to be transmitted to the people who need to use it. And that leads us into another massive thing we've built: our electrical grid. There's no one single weight for it, but in the US, just the wires in our three electrical grids stretch more than 8.8 million kilometers, connecting the roughly 11,000 power plants to homes and businesses across the country. And these are not light cables. The truly massive aluminum steel ones, like you might find in overhead wires, can weigh up to 4 tons per kilometer. Of course, different sizes of cables are used for different purposes. You don't need a super high capacity monster to just hook up your house to the grid. But even so, any weight multiplied by millions of kilometers is going to end up being a big number. And even if the real average is only like a tenth of the mass of these monster cables, that's still over 3 million tons of electrical cables. And that's not even counting the power plants, transformers, transmission towers, and all the other stuff that the system needs to work. Of course, depending on how you count what's a part of the electrical grid, its total mass is changing. Because one of the big transformations going on right now is finding better ways to integrate renewable energy. And that often comes from many small generators, like rooftop solar or small wind farms, instead of single massive power plants. While we're talking about cables, we may as well shout out the internet too. At a typical weight of 1.4 tons per kilometer, there must be something like 1.8 million tons of undersea cables alone. And that's all to move itty-bitty particles, like photons and electrons. Over a decade ago, one physicist calculated that all the electrons that make up the information stored on the entire internet have a combined mass equivalent to a strawberry. Lastly, our final example is another case where we had to build something very large to handle something very small. One of the largest machines that humanity has ever built is underground, straddling the border between France and Switzerland. It's the Large Hadron Collider, or LHC. It's hard to pin down a single figure for its total, but we do know some of the individual components. Like, there are 1,200 tons of electrical cables that power a 27-kilometer-long ring of super powerful electromagnets, and over 10,000 metric tons of coolant are needed to keep about 37,000 tons of equipment at the right temperature. Plus, there are the detectors that collect the actual data, like Atlas, which weighs in at 7,000 metric tons, and the CMS, that's 14,000 metric tons. The LHC had to be this massive in order for physicists to learn about some of the tiniest things in the universe, subatomic particles. And by learning more about how they work and interact with one another, we'll get a clearer picture about all of this. See, here's the problem. The fundamental building blocks of reality as we know it are very tightly bound up inside regular matter. So we need to hit larger subatomic particles like protons very, very hard to get them to break apart. And that means getting them to move very, very fast. Scientists can do that using magnets. And the more magnets you have, the faster you can make charged particles go. But the faster they go, the wider a track you need. It's just like a race car track. Too tight, and the particles fly off course. Technically, you can make particle accelerators that are small enough to fit on a desk, but as we've looked for ever smaller, rarer, and more fundamental particles, we've needed to smash them together ever harder with even more energy. So over the years, they got bigger and bigger until they reached the massive machines of today. And now, CERN has proposed building an even bigger particle accelerator to explore even more extreme particles, like whatever makes up dark matter. That said, the member states won't vote on that proposal until 2028, and if it gets approved, it wouldn't even be fully operational until the 2070s. So check back in 5 decades when SciShow pulls me out of retirement for one final hosting gig. Sometimes studying the biggest, most massive things humans have ever built means peering into the past. Sometimes it means understanding the effects, not always great ones, we're having on our world right now. And sometimes it means harnessing immense amounts of power, all in the name of creating the future and exploring the universe. All thanks to some clever engineering and good project managers who aren't afraid of a big job.